Good morning or good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to this webinar on RodiMet. Today we will focus on hydroxymethionine, the value-added methionine. Maybe you have watched the last live webinar with Dr. Pierre-André Guérard, Professor Mike Kidd and Dr. Jaap van Mingen on amino acids beyond building blocks. And to continue on this topic, we propose you today to speak about methionine among all other amino acids because of its specific status. In fact, methionine is an essential amino acid and is involved in DNA methylation, protein deposition, and other applications, and is also a precursor of cysteine. So, in fact, as such, animals need to fulfill their requirement in methionine to reach their optimal performance. And feed producers have the opportunity to fulfill this requirement in methionine with various effective sources of methionine. For example, there is DLM methionine, which is the preferred sources of premixer or small feed miller. And then there is also liquid hydroxymethionine, which is the best option for a large feed miller and also integrators. And in fact, these molecules are chemically different, so they have different characteristics, and it will be the topic of discussion today. And to discuss all these subjects, I'm really pleased to welcome today two R&D nutrition researchers from the CERN, which is the Center of Expertise and Research in Nutrition of Adisseo, based in Commentry. So first, welcome to Dr. Dolores Batonon-Alevo, who is a Global Scientific Solution Developer at Adisseo.
Thank you very much, and hello everyone.
Thank you. And Dr. Yves Mercier, who is in charge of RodiMet scientific and technical support, also at Adisseo. So welcome, Yves.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone.
So as a start, I propose to have a closer look at the methionine source and their characteristics. So Yves, I propose to start by you. Can you give us some more information about these methionine sources available for a feed producer?
Yeah. In fact, it exists two main methionine sources in the field and is available on the market. The first one is the DL methionine, which is a powder form with a 99% purity. And the second one is the hydroxy analog of methionine, we consider as hydroxymethionine, which is a liquid form with 88% purity. In fact, these molecules are both synthesized by chemical processes, giving a mix of a D and L form at 50% each of these forms. And the animal have to transform this D form into L methionine in order it can be usable by the animal.
And Yves, to continue on this topic, can you give us the main difference between those molecules?
In fact, the main difference is the one DL methionine is a true amino acid with an amino group, and the hydroxymethionine, in that case, the amino group is replaced by an hydroxy group, which is transform into amino group later on. And the fact that this molecule has an hydroxy group instead of an amino group transform it into, we can say, an organic acid, and it confer it a specific acidifying value. And for instance, this molecule has a pKa of 3.4.
And Dolores, to continue, does this molecule structure that Yves just mentioned, so we have an amino group for DLM and an hydroxyl group for hydroxymethionine, so does this difference have consequences on the intestinal absorption by the animal?
Yes, Florian, thank you for the question. So yes, we do have some differences about the absorption. The first one for DLHMTBA is absorbed by passive diffusion and through active transporters, Na+, H+ transporters, which are common to monocarboxylic acids and named MCT1. On the other side, we have DL methionine, which is absorbed specifically using active transporters, which are common to all natural amino acids, like lysine, for example. And the other consequence is that DL-HMTBA is faster absorbed than DL-methionine, like you can see on the graph. Its absorption is completed by the end of the duodenum, while DL-methionine is mainly absorbed at a jejunal level, like other amino acids.
So if I well understood, and if you will confirm me that, both forms are finally L-methionine precursor. So what about the conversion of these molecules into L-methionine?
Yeah, Florian, you are totally right. In fact, they are both L-methionine precursors. And both of these methionine sources have to go through a different steps to be transformed into L-methionine to be usable by the animal. And this transformation or conversion is done through a specific enzymatic reaction using a specific oxidase or dehydrogenase, leading to obtain which we call the KMB molecule for keto-methyl-thio-butanoic acid, which is a complicated name, but what you have to get is that this molecule is a keto form, and this keto form do not have anymore the L or D form. After these steps, a second step of transamination will appear by taking an amino group from other amino acids and transform the molecule KMB into L-methionine that can be used by the animal for protein synthesis and other use.
So, in fact, all these molecules, as you said, are L-methionine precursor. So we can wonder, what about their bioefficacy? So we know that there are various trials comparing the effect of DL-methionine and hydroxymethionine on animal performance that are existing. So we can mention, for example, a trial with Scott Horsfield research in 2014 and also with Bark in 2015. And in fact, the conclusion of this is that the full relative bioefficacy of hydroxymethionine compared to DL-methionine is 100%. So really an equivalence in terms of performance. And in fact, I propose for the second part of this webinar to focus on the bioefficacy and the methodology to have this bioefficacy. So, Dolores, I will start by you. How can we be sure that the comparison of methionine source is accurate? And what is the methodology that we can use?
Yeah, that's a great question, actually, Florian, because there are plenty of studies over there and people don't really understand what is the right statistical tool to use to compare methionine sources. But first of all, in order to compare this DL-methionine to DL-HMTBA, we usually use a standard basal diet, which is deficient in sulfur amino acid, and then we add gradual doses of each product. Once we done that and we get the performance, we applied exponential models with a common intercept. The intercept here is the performance of the basal diet and a separate plateau. So we have a common intercept, but not a common plateau. And since we know that DL-HMTBA have different sites of absorption, different conversion pathway that Yves just told you about, they don't have the same growth response curve, DLM and DL-HMTBA. Therefore, we cannot use an exponential model with a common plateau to compare them. That's not the right appropriate method to use to compare them. And so once we use an exponential model with separate plateau, we then calculate the bioefficacy or the relative bioefficacy, or what we also call the biological value, by calculating the ratio between the stepneck coefficients of each growth response curve. And we get a confidence interval around this value. And since the confidence interval includes the value 100, we can conclude that DLM and HMTBA are fully equivalent and are 100% bioefficacious in broilers and swine.
And after this theoretical demonstration, can you show us a practical example?
Yes, so what we did at CERN in our R&D department, we performed a trial comparing D-L-methionine, D-L-HMTBA, and L-methionine, which Yves just told you about, which is the native form of the methionine, on broilers reared from 0 to 42 days old. And we use a standard basal diet based on corn and soybean meal and gradual doses of each product. So once we get the performance of those methionine sources, there is no significant difference between them, and the overall body weight gain was plotted against the total sulfur amino acid intake, just like you can see on the graph, and there is no difference on the growth response curve. Then we applied the exponential model that I was talking about, and you can see on the right part that we get the relative bioefficacy value, and they are around 100%. In addition to that, we get the confidence interval, which also include the value 100. So based on that, we can conclude that the three methionine sources, DL-methionine, HMTB, and L-methionine, are all three equivalent and at 100% efficacious in animals.
And Dolores, I noticed that you use total sulfur amino acid intake instead of the dose. What is the interest, in fact, to do so?
Yeah, you were right about it. I did use total sulfur amino acid intake, which is calculated using the total feed intake, and the analyzed methionine and cysteine level in the diet. So we use these criteria to take into account the minor variations that can be observed in feed intake, depending on floor pens, for example, and also the analyze methionine and cysteine levels, knowing that sometimes we can have some minor variation about the incorporation weight. So by doing so, this allows us to strengthen the comparison between the methionine sources and then to come to the conclusion that, yes, we do not have any difference between methionine sources.
Great. And so we've seen that the bioefficacy is the same between the sources. And also, we mentioned at the beginning of the webinar that hydroxymethionine has additional value beyond this performance, and it's not only for protein deposition, but there is a valuable outcome for the feed producer. So I propose to focus the next part on these additional benefits. And Yves, maybe you can start and share with us one of the specificity of hydroxymethionine that can be of interest for feed producer.
Yeah, in fact, we are talking for minutes now around methionine, but in fact, as Dolores said, animals need total sulfur amino acids, and which is important is methionine, but also cysteine and other sulfur compounds, which are really important for growth and other function for the cell. Back to 2006, what we get, in fact, with a published paper by Dr. Raquel Martin-Venegas, it was that the HMTBA was more transsulfurated and giving more taurine and cysteine compared to DLM.
What is the interest to get seeing more of these compounds?
In fact, first point is that animal diets are, in general, deficient in methionine, but also in cysteine. And cysteine is really needed for protein synthesis. But also, cysteine has another advantage, is a precursor of other molecules like glutathione or like taurine, which are well known to be really involved in the antioxidants process within the cells. And by obtaining more of these compounds, in fact, we can have a better redox status for the cell.
And in which condition this enhanced redox status is interesting for the animal performance?
In fact, there is many conditions where the heat stress is rising, and maybe one of the most known is the heat stress condition, where there is a loss of performance, but One part is due to the decrease in feed intake, but a part is also due to the increase and the rise of radical oxygen spaces. And we had performed a study some years ago comparing methionine sources under heat stress condition, and we get that, in fact, the performance were improved by using HMTBA compared to DLM, and this effect can be attributed to a better redox balance, what we can see on the right part of the graph, considered by the reduced glutathione compared to the total glutathione, which is increased with the usage of HMTBA compared to DLM. And of course, increasing this ratio means a better redox status for the animal.
And the rest who go further in this discussion, can you share with us some other advantages linked to the hydroxymethionine compared to DL methionine?
Yeah, we just heard an example for broilers, and here is another one in swine. We know, for example, that sows must be supplemented with enough nutrients in order to ensure better maternal health, reproductive performance, but also protein utilization. And there are plenty of studies that have demonstrated that particularly during the late gestation phase, sows must be given enough amino acids in order to help them to go through the lactation phase. So thanks to its absorption pathway, we did a trial with an increase of HMTBA and DL methionine. And we demonstrated that with HMTBA, we have an increase of fat, of protein and lactose in the milk. And as a consequence for that, sucking piglets have a higher body weight and were enhanced in their antioxidant status that will help them to cope with any oxidative stress that may happen during the post-weaning period, just like we heard from Eve for broilers, for example.
Mm. Thank you for this highlight. So, in fact, you show both of you that hydroxymethionine has really greater advantage and additional value compared to DL methionine in terms of performance during heat stress, or Dolores, what you mentioned, in terms of increased sow milk quality. So, really, there are a lot of value of this molecule. And we are not at the end of the story. Other things will come. So now we are arriving at the end of this webinar. So I would like to thank you warmly, both Dolores Bâtonnant-Lalvaux and Yves Mercier, for all this interesting highlight and discussion. And also, I encourage you behind your screen to ask questions to the email address feedchannel@feedchannel.online, and we will answer shortly. So I thank you, all of you, and you for watching, and stay tuned on Feed Channel. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.